wisdom,
prudentia,
justice,
justitia,
temperance,
temperantia,
courage,
fortitudo.
Applying ancient philosophy to modern life, this is the Sunday Stoic.
Moral Letters to Lucilius by Seneca, number 76, on learning wisdom in old age.
And what quality is best in man? It is reason. By virtue of reason he surpasses the animals, and is surpassed only by the gods. Perfect reason is therefore the good peculiar to man. All other qualities he shares in some degree with the animals and plants. This perfect reason is called virtue.
Today's guest is Kai Whiting. Kai is a lecturer and researcher based at the University of Lisbon in Portugal. He is the lead author on two recent papers that involve Stoicism: Sustainable Development, Well-being, and Material Consumption, A Stoic Perspective. And the subject of this podcast, the newest paper, Were Neanderthals Rational? A Stoic Approach. Both are open access publications, and I will put links in the show notes. Kai has recently discussed the paper on sustainability on several podcasts, including the Stoic Solutions podcast and the Practical Stoic podcast. Check them out. Welcome to the show, Kai.
Thanks, Steve, for having me. It's great to be here.
So, Kai, just to get a little introduction here, how long have you been studying the philosophy of Stoicism?
It's not been long. So I didn't have a podcast. So it's been a year or so that things started to develop for me and I really got into Stoicism. So I won't repeat here. But as a lecturer and a researcher since October, which doesn't sound like a long time until you realize I've probably dedicated 5 to 10 hours a day on the subject and read around it. So in terms of like duration, if you look in terms of yearly, you'd say, oh, this man hasn't studied at all. But if you look in terms of density of like how much Stoicism I fit in for particular days, a lot. So I've tried to cover a lot of ground, unusual ground, because my weakness, I would say, would be that I've not rehearsed in philosophy. I'm not a philosopher. I'm an environmental engineer. So I had to find a sort of slightly different approach to, say, the traditional philosophical or psychological connection that many other academics in Stoicism have used and brought to a general audience attention.
So what is your field of study then? At least from what's your university training?
So there's environmental science, sustainable materials, sustainable energy, sustainable development. Anything that says environmental or sustainable is generally comes under my wing, and I try to develop something from there. So the first paper that we did looking at well-being, material consumption, material services, that is quote unquote my day job. But I realized that there was something more to be said, because like in the Neanderthal paper, I wanted to look at our relationship between human beings, Homo sapiens, and the rest of the world in terms of the environment, how we treat animals. So I felt that the Neanderthals was like a bridge, a midpoint. Say, okay, how far does the line between us and everything else blur? So that's why that paper got written.
I was reading through your paper on Were Neanderthals Rational and how they may compare to Homo sapiens, and I never did find the part of your paper where you discuss your time machine, because obviously you're planning on spending some time with Neanderthals. I mean, why else would you write a paper on Were Neanderthals Rational and would we consider them human?
Absolutely. I mean, I needed to find a wife over there. So I thought, okay, let's go. Let's see if it's really true, whether I can actually reproduce or not. So yeah, that was really exciting. And it was kind of a time machine, because we start, and it sounds funny, it's a good joke, but it really was, because you're sitting there thinking everything that you thought was true about something wasn't. And when you went back into how you'd understood something, like how I understood humans to be, or how I understood humans to think, or how I understood humans to behave, everything changed. So we started, the question is, would we put them in a zoo? And then by revisiting my own misunderstandings, my own prejudices, I was able to come to a much more holistic and reasonable, I would say reasonable, or rational understanding of what it means to be human. So it kind of did feel like a time machine, is to revisit everything that you thought you knew. Unfortunately, I couldn't go there myself in person, but in my mind, I was thinking, would I put them in a zoo? And then I went to, would I make love to a Neanderthal? Would I have children with Neanderthal? Would that ever happen? How would that work? Would I have to have some form of communication that isn't just physical? And so, I mean, it sounds like a strange thing to do, but as a researcher, you really do have to think through the implications of what you're suggesting.
I didn't realize this would be such a racy podcast. Okay, so just to frame this discussion, so from a Stoic point of view, at least an ancient Stoic view, what unites all of humanity?
Well, the ability to form a coherent. Well, I first have to say that talking about a neurotypical person. So I know that people have already said to me, "Well, what about?" And they've given me a particular individual. So we're not talking here, Steve, you and I, about a particular individual. We're talking about the average, you know, the example of the species, which you would call in biology what again?
A type specimen. So if you describe a new species, you pick one, even though there's variety within the species, you pick one as the representative, if you will, of that species and describe it in biology. And then, you know, you might say, but there are others that vary in slightly different ways. But as a biologist, for example, we might define what a human is from our perspective. And maybe rationality is part of that description. But if you have someone who, maybe you say communication is part of that description. But if someone's born and they can't speak, that doesn't make them less human. They just aren't the typical human.
Exactly. So that was something I just needed to clarify. So in terms of what makes a human human? So in terms of their ability to reason, so an adult, ability to be coherent and consistent, ability to have a working memory, for example, to hold two thoughts in one's mind at the same time, right? So that's particularly human is cumulative culture, which is like what Isaac Newton says, standing on the shoulders of giants, you can see further. You haven't got anything, say, in the cat world, where you teach a cat to do something and suddenly they teach all the other cats and then cats are building castles. We haven't seen that, right? So that's a really major ability that humans have. So we ask the question, like, what does it mean for the individual? So the ability to communicate in terms of understanding and empathizing, to be able to learn something to the point that you're able to teach it, to be able to connect with another person enough to explain what you want in a sexual way, but not to be just a physically based relationship, so that you have the idea of kinship. And then how that proliferates in a wider society or in a cultural setting, because animals to a certain extent do have some kind of culture, but nowhere that could be comparative to human development or human civilization. No one would say cats are civilized, right? In terms of they haven't constructed the culture that they have into something that becomes a very big macro structure. They might have a minor kind of culture or a minor language difference between, say, two different groups of birds. They might have slightly different, say, accents when they sing because they're in one area and the other birds in another area. But it's not to the point where you can suddenly transfer an idea and make the idea convert into a different idea and then develop off that. That's something that evades all other non-human species. With the Neanderthals, we started to ask the question, how much cumulative culture did they have? So we know we have suggestions within the community. So paleoanthropologists are saying that they would bury their dead. They were able to understand some kind of symbolism. They did take part in, say, artistic works. But how quickly could they took that work and developed it into something greater than they'd already produced? How quickly could they have transformed an idea or concept or a tool into something that we would now see as a great accomplishment in modern society?
A Neanderthal magnum opus.
Exactly. So that's something that it's very challenging. I mean, it's very controversial. We've had a lot of controversies already. It's been around on Facebook for the best part of the week because it does conflict with everything that you thought you knew about being human. And when you start to say, for example, you know, there's interbreeding that many Europeans and Asians have percentages of Neanderthals and other human species. I would suggest a human species. That creates problems, right? That creates conflict. And even the question, like, would I make love to a Neanderthal? It's quite a funny thing to say, but it's a relevant scientific question. But that will make people uncomfortable because we have this prejudice that we are superior, we are the superior being, they're inferior, we would be taking advantage of them, when actually it would be the opposite way around, because if it's the male Neanderthal that would be able to have fertile children with the female Homo sapiens. So that kind of thing makes us uncomfortable. So Steve, I just wanted you to unpack what I mean by the superiority and inferiority and how that has sort of been developed in your field through the imagery that you guys use.
Okay. Originally everyone sort of viewed humanity and other organisms' relationships in that scala naturae, the sort of the ladder of nature, with more primitive beings towards the bottom and humans at the top and then angels and gods above. And that kind of is the way a lot of people still frame humanity. We think of that picture that they always show of the monkey and like the different evolutionary stages of humanity, and then the modern human at the end, all walking in a single file line. We often think about evolution that way, but the more appropriate way to think about it is like a branching bush, where shoots give rise to new shoots. So, for example, with humanity and Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalis, they are branches of the same original branch, and they were side by side. They lived at the same time. So Neanderthals were not ancestors to humanity, but they were similar enough still to apparently, the evidence suggests, to interbreed, because I know I myself have 2% or so Neanderthal DNA in my own genome. I had myself tested. So apparently some of my ancestors either found them attractive or were had a forcible interaction with a Neanderthal. And as you said, it appears that the relationship must have been male Neanderthal to female Homo sapien, because the mitochondrial DNA that we all inherit is all completely Homo sapien with no Neanderthal DNA present. And one of the simplest explanations for that is that male Neanderthals mated with female Homo sapiens, because mitochondrial DNA or mitochondria are only inherited from our mothers. So there's a lot of information in that jibber jabber I just gave you, but it's best to think of evolution as a branching bush rather than a ladder.
And why do you think, Steve, that it did start as a ladder? Why did that come about, in your opinion, as a biologist?
Well, because we have a unique position as humans. We are the people, we are the species creating the classification. We are trying to figure out how nature works. And as the species coming up with the classification, we want to put ourselves on the top. We think of ourselves as being quite important. And so, just because of the bias of who's building the classification system, but also, cultural and religious, ideas fuel into that. And if you think you are a special creation, then, and that you are above the other animals, then naturally you draw yourself on top. So there's a number of reasons why we would have thought about it that way. It's sort of like the scientific method. We have various hypotheses. That was a hypothesis of how life worked, but the evidence in reality just doesn't back up the scale of nature, the ladder of nature, like the branching bush. Sort of the phylogenetic approach is supported by the evidence.
I mean, absolutely. The thing is interesting about Stoics is that for them, like the most rational being, the ancient Stoics, was the universe. So that has made a few other people uncomfortable. And they're like, how can you say that? I'm like, I didn't say it. I'm just telling you how it was viewed, that the logos was the element of rationality that existed in us. It's the spark of Zeus, right?
Right. Like the almost like Zeus, just like they thought the body had a soul, Zeus was the soul of the universe almost. Yeah.
And a little like spark of that was in each and every human being. And that was defined by the ability as an adult human to rationalize, to act consistently, to act coherently, to understand, say, the virtues. So, for example, just a quick one. If you think about justice, we often talk in society about animal rights, but animals never claim their own rights. It's always acted upon by a human being. So a human being can right. identify where there's an injustice occurring towards a non-human entity, right? That doesn't have to be a living being, actually. That could be a landscape, a natural park, a national park. So you have to sit there and say, we have the ability to rationalize, and we have the ability to live out virtue. Does a dog, is a dog just? And you say, well, it's very difficult, because if a dog is unjust, then we have to trial them in their court. And then we would not be able to discuss with them how their behavior was unjust. And that sounds uncomfortable, because people will say, but my dog is rational. And I say, yeah, there are some elements of activity that suggests that there is a relationship that you have between you and your pet. And there is an element of consideration, kindness even perhaps, or love, or a codependency, right? Because we always depend on our pets sometimes as much as they depend on us. But that isn't, something where you could say to the dog, you need to act with self-control. If I put your food in your bowl, could you only eat half of it, right? That dog typically, unless unwell, will eat until it's full, and then the dog will continue to eat. So, although that, again, people say my dog is rational, but trying to tell your dog to act with self-control, it's just not possible. So that...
I will say my dog waits till I get out some cheese to put on the dog food before he will... I think that's more of a spoiled trait rather than a rational.
That's
trait.
Excellent. So if you don't put cheese on there, does that mean that your dog will not eat the meal ever?
Eventually he will acquiesce to the situation, but he waits and watches for a while to see, will Steve cave in and bring me some goodies? In the reading I have at the beginning of the podcast, Seneca tells us that humanity does share a lot of traits with the animals, and in some traits, animals outperform humans, in physical strength and endurance and things. And so he says that perfect rationality is shared with humanity, among humanity. That doesn't mean that some animals don't have some rationality. As with all philosophical constructs and biology, there's always fuzzy edges to things. But I talked to you a little bit about the an earlier conversation about the bull on our family farm and my relationship with it and how it learned who I was. We had a bull on the family farm, and I would put my hands behind my back and sniff it. I'll give a good sound effect here. With my hands behind my back, I seemed unthreatening, and the bull would sniff back. And I would do that for a few days, and then I started to reach my hands around slowly, and I began to scratch the bull's ears and his head. And eventually he came to know me and liked having his head scratched. And within a few weeks of this, even if I wasn't around and my dad would pull in with his car, the car I normally rode in, the bull would start bawling and sticking his head out of the fence as far as possible and begging to have his neck rubbed. Even if I wasn't there, he recognized the vehicle that I normally arrived in. So there's definitely memory there and some form of what we might call rationality. Like, car, usually when that car arrives, normally the next thing that happens is I get a neck rub. So I'm going to beg for it a little bit. So it's interesting to see those little sparks of behavior in animals that make you question how rational is this organism? And at the same time, how irrational is it? If you get in the pen with him, you might find out that was a terrible mistake.
Absolutely. I mean, I wouldn't want to be a red flag to a bull.
No.
I think that's a clear thing that we're trying to say here, because I know a lot of people are really attached to their animals. That in Stoicism, there are no animal rights because of the things that we talked about. There is no way to allow currently an animal to testify in court. And in fact, humans have no rights. Okay, so there is an obligation in terms of our rationality sometimes to save our moral self. instead of our physical self. So that is why suicide, interestingly enough, is permitted, or at least an option in Stoicism, when your physical being would, the saving of your physical being would come into conflict with your moral being. So we talk in Stoicism a lot about obligations through the circles of concern. So when I say there's no animal rights, before you jump up and down at me or send me the hate mail at trollme.com, please be aware that there are no human rights. There are none. But we do have obligations towards each other. So in our circles of concern, the first paper, the one about sustainability and material consumption, we tried to propose an extension of the original circles of concern to add sort of earth layer. And we didn't separate animals and plants from, say, rocks, because we didn't know how to distinguish, particularly between the obligation towards a wild animal or a wild plant, as opposed to an obligation towards their habitat. Because, say, for example, saving a panda but not saving their habitat would mean that the panda would be stuck in a zoo, or would be in a place where they couldn't live naturally and support themselves. So that's why we added something with the earth to take into consideration all the new non-human elements. Of course, if you have a pet that were chained because you have put that pet in your house and in an unnatural, quote unquote, unnatural environment, so the obligation towards you would be greater because you've taken responsibility. In your case, Steve, when the dog arrived quite unexpectedly. So
yeah. If anyone needs a dog, by the way, email me at sundaystoic@gmail.com.
Yeah, because, I mean, but then that comes into your circle of concern, right? So I just wanted to ask you how you feel as a Stoic, knowing that you have now got an extra obligation, as it were, towards the non-human world.
Yeah, so I'm sitting with my son at 5 a.m. when he woke up early and look out the window, and there's a dog staring back in at me. And I have a dog, and now I have two until I find this other dog a home. And I won't lie, I should have read some Marcus Aurelius before looking out the window to remind myself of the stuff that might happen during the day, because I looked out and went, oh, a dog. Because normally when there's a dog in my yard, it means someone has dumped it, or it's ran away from home or something. And so I went out, and the dog was very, very sheepish and shy, and like it had not been perhaps treated well, or it was scared anyway of me. I don't know what its old owner was like, but it did have a shock collar on that we removed, and then the dog's personality changed dramatically, and we gave it food and water, and now it's sort of moved in. And I feel like it's important to take care of things that can never give you anything in return other than a lick on the face. You know, it's important to take care of critters that might be depending on you, rather than shooing the dog away and closing your doors to it. I would have done the same thing before ever cracking open a Stoic text, though. So I can't say that Stoicism informed the way I behave towards other organisms to that extent. But I guess the right thing to do is the right thing to do, and taking care of an organism that's in need, if you have the ability to do so, seemed like the right thing to do.
I mean, absolutely. It's so encouraging that, you know, you see a dog on the doorstep and you say, you know what, it's my obligation, because if I don't do it, that dog is going to go around with a collar and it's going to have a terrible life. As you said, it was almost instantaneous, this trust that came into that relationship. I think the difficult thing is that when you start to say things like, okay, what's my obligation to the rainforest? Because obviously the obligation to a dog is slightly more clear cut, because it's literally on your doorstep. Right. But what's your obligation when you want some material for your iPhone, and that requires a mine, and that mine happens to be in a vulnerable area? And I think as Stoics, we need to then identify that and say, how much do I need an iPhone? Do I need one? Is it something that I want to identify with? If that comes at a cost to, say, the Amazon rainforest or the forest of Indonesia, or even like, you know, the great, the red oaks in the US that have been cut down and destroyed? So there's these kind of questions. And I wanted to ask you a bit about, for example, the passenger pigeon, which you identified to me in an early conversation. Like, what would have been our obligation as Stoics towards that particular animal.
All right. Well, like you said in your paper, it's not necessarily focused on Neanderthals. I mean, they're like the model that we're looking at, but the question is also how do we relate to non-human entities beyond the genus Homo? And one of the organisms that I teach about in my biology class is the passenger pigeon. So in 1800, there were 4 billion of them. And by 1900, there were 100 of them. And they were extinct by 1914, I believe. And they would darken the skies with the size of their flocks. But the issue arose, like you said, you can't save a species while destroying its habitat. Everything's interlinked and interconnected very deeply. And so we were clearing the forests, removing their food, you know, nuts and things, and their roosting spots. And at the same time, we were hunting them and eating them. And so they were decimated within 100 years. And as a Stoic, you want to live an examined life and stop just doing what everyone around you is doing and step back and say, what is the consequence of this action, or what does it say about me when I do this? And is this the just thing to do? Is this the wise thing to do? Or we don't have a passenger pigeon now, and is humanity worse off for it? Well, our sense of wonder is diminished. I personally would like to have been able to have seen passenger pigeons. And I think they had, you know, I think humanity's role is to know better. We are supposed to be wiser than we tend to act. And we have seen time and time again in the past where we haven't thought about our actions until it's far too late.
I think that is sort of the crux of why this paper was written, because the reason why we picked Neanderthals was the historical analysis is, oh, this is a chimpanzee, it has not much to do with us, right? But it's only because between the chimpanzee and us, Homo sapiens, everything else died out. So right. It's easier to draw a line in the sand and say this is us and this is them, because I don't like using this expression, but the intermediate species are no longer with us.
You can think about it the same way. If you draw an evolutionary tree, birds and crocodiles come out side by side. But all of the dinosaurs were between them, and they're gone. So if you draw a tree of who's alive now, alligators and birds and crocodiles and birds are side by side, which seems weird until you realize all of the diversity that's now gone that once was between those two groups.
Exactly. And so it was actually Richard Dawkins that talks about it in Speciesism, and say once you realize that Neanderthals are extremely similar to us, he wouldn't say Neanderthals, but he said there were species that are very similar to what we consider to be human today. It is no longer viable. And he says there's no moral high ground in not being a vegan, that's what he says, or having a plant-based diet. Is that something to me is a very interesting statement, and I don't want to go into like what diet one should have, other than suffice to say, for example, with tuna, the way that we catch tuna has decimated the dolphin population. Now, they're the most intelligent animal we have on the earth today, apart from us, which I do mention in the paper, by the way. So they're the most intelligent animal that we have. And yet, because we want canned tuna, which is a horrible way of eating tuna, by the way, we are decimating them. And they'll say, but I buy dolphin friendly. And I just like to highlight that in 2016, there was a Greenpeace research report saying that you only have to catch 2% dolphin friendly in order to have the logo dolphin friendly. Wow. So you have to really do your research. I mean, I can only say in the UK, for example, that there's Marks and Spencers and Waitrose. Their supermarkets do have a great percentage, but don't be fooled by a logo that says dolphin friendly, because only 2% of the catch has to register as pole caught or line caught rather than net caught. So what happens generally is that they'll say that they're dolphin friendly, but 98% of the dolphins will be captured in a net, re-emptied out onto the deck, right, and left to basically drown in the air. And then they are throwing the dead body back in. And it's so vicious because, and I use the word vicious with intent, because they trick the dolphin into playing with them. The dolphins like to swim along the boat and literally enjoy spending time with the fishermen until it's too late. And it reminds me of like Hansel and Gretel a little bit, like tricking the children and then like trying to use their innocence against them. So as a lecturer, I say, look, I don't really mind what you eat, but at least try not to eat canned tuna. Like, it really isn't the way forward. Because of the way I look at it now, particularly as a Stoic, I don't think about necessarily animal versus plant, more like rational and versus non-rational, and the degrees of rationality, the degrees of intelligence. And I think if, for example, if the Stoics had known about the intelligence of certain animals, they would certainly have identified with them more. I mean, I know there's this conversations about bees and ants working together and sharing some kind of community feel. But I really think that if people understood how dolphins were being hunted, they would refrain from eating canned tuna and would pick, say, for example, canned salmon, because that would be salmon farmed. And there are issues with that. I'm not saying that it's a perfect switch, but certainly it doesn't seem as cruel. So as a Stoic, I kind of ask people to question, like, what are your values and what do you see as wise? Is destroying the most intelligent creature on earth, because it's not a chimpanzee, people think it's a chimpanzee, it's not. Is that a wise decision? I don't know, Steve, what is your thought on that?
Jeez. I would say that being a sage would be hard. trying to dig up the rationality of everything you do, like, oh, if I eat this, ah, crap. If I eat that, ah, crap. The one thing you'll notice when you're studying Stoicism is that ethics start to play a role in every single thing you do. One of the things that we do all the time, and as Musonius Rufus says, one of the ways we can screw up if we're trying to be a Stoic, the easiest place to mess up is at the dinner table, because we eat several times a day if we're lucky, and he would recommend, you know, the lacto vegetarian sort of a diet, according to, from what I recall from reading Musonius Rufus. But other Stoics further in the past, sounds like they were fine with eating, pigs, if I remember correctly. I think you comment on that in your paper as well, that they thought that the gods gave the pigs life just so they wouldn't rot before we could eat them, which is a little rough. These are things I'm still pondering, like, how do I implement this into my life?
Yeah, it's an absolute challenge. I mean, Stoicism, the hardest thing, somebody asked me on another podcast, an environmental podcast, what's the hard thing about being a Stoic? And I said, well, the consistency. You have to commit to being consistent, to being rational as much as you can every single day. And you have to give up food that, for example, if that story resonated with you and you went and researched, maybe you'd have to give up something you really like. People ask, for example, I'm vegetarian. People ask me, don't you miss steak? Yes. Who doesn't miss steak? Who doesn't? I smell steak and I like the smell of it in terms of because I remember the taste. But I just say to myself, is that something that I need? Now, would I, if I went to your house, Stephen, you offered me a steak, would I eat it? Yes, I wouldn't eat tuna, but I would eat the steak you put in front of me.
Well, my brother raises cattle, so they are as ethically raised cattle as you're going to find, at least.
So I would eat that because I feel like, okay, it's not something that I would buy, but I would say that our friendship is worth something that I would value personally, and people might disagree with me, but I would value that more than the occasional steak. Now, that doesn't mean that I would commit to eating steak every time. And I might say to you, well, if this steak comes from your brother's farm and it's only once a month, then I'm happily, we can have a barbecue, whatever you like. And I might say to you, how about you consider like reducing your tuna? We can do like a partway thing and then the world's a little bit better off. So I would be a bit sneaky as well.
Right.
But it is hard being a Stoic. And that's, you know, when I was more religious, and I no longer am, it was easier. It was easy to say, well, because, say, for example, God, since Noah's time, gave us the animals. He gave us permission to eat. The covenant between God and Noah wasn't just about the rainbow, about the rain. It was also about, okay, now you can eat the animals. Right? Before that, there was no eating of animals. It was not sanctioned by the Lord. So it was very easy for me to say, well, God said it was okay, right? And then when that changed in my life, and subsequently Stoicism became more important, I suddenly have to question a lot more. I had to, particularly my role as an environmental lecturer, right? I had to question, is this reasonable? Is this rational? I mean, I don't drive, so I have to ask questions like, what car should I have? Because I know as an environmental lecturer what climate change means. But if anybody owns a car, then they have to ask themselves that question. What does it mean to have a car? Which car should I buy? And you're absolutely right, Steve. It's an incredibly difficult thing to do. And I'm not suggesting that we be mindful in every single thing that we do, because that would be impossible. But to pick something and say, what do I actually know about this? What does this, you know, lead me to being wiser? Does this lead to a greater sense of justice? Does this lead to a greater sense of self-control? You know, these are the kind of questions. Is this a courageous step for me? Like telling my friends that I'm not getting tuna at Subway. That might be courageous. People might mock you for that. I've been mocked in the environmental department for being too extreme because I don't want to eat meat. And then you can't take it that seriously. But to me, when I lecture, I don't want my students to turn around and say to me, "You're hypocritical." That to me, as a Stoic, is just not the way forward. And they know that. I'm Stoic.
They say one way you can tell when you're progressing, when you're kind of aligned, when you're the same person in front of a crowd as when you're by yourself, or no matter who's watching, and when your thoughts and your actions are becoming more and more aligned, you're progressing. So it sounds like you're working hard at that.
Well, I think it's easier for me because I've got like 12 years grounding in this stuff. It's a lot harder, for example, the personal or psychological stuff, say that Donald Robertson talks about, or Massimo is much more focused on, that to me doesn't come so naturally. So it's easy for me to say that, you know, because I've got 12 years experience, then the base of knowledge that I have makes it easier for me to make better decisions. And that's why I say to Stoics, get your knowledge base in, especially this post-truth that you have in America. It's not a world, I don't think it's a world phenomenon. We don't have it here in Portugal, for example, but in the US, it doesn't matter anymore if it's true or not. It matters who it comes from. Credibility is who you
and
are.
How loud it is, yeah.
Exactly, and how loud it is. And I think as Stoics, we need to be very careful about, like, just because such and such a person says it, doesn't make it more or less true.
Right.
Right. Doesn't make it more or less virtuous. It's either just or it's not. And that's why I think Stoicism is, in the end, a very simple philosophy. It's either just or it isn't. We either got the whole hog or we don't. So that, I think, in the post-truth that you're living out there in the US, is something that we should bear in mind. And particularly, for example, if we use Twitter or Facebook, because algorithms will direct our attention to certain ways of thinking. So it's very dangerous to only use our social media to obtain news, because it will feed whatever bias that we have, even if we don't realize it. So,
and as Stoics, we have ethics that we talk about a lot, but there's also the study of logic and the study of physics or science, and we can't forget to think about logic and trying to not fall into biased thinking, and that's something we don't talk about a lot in Stoicism right now, but that was one of the tenets of Stoicism in back in the day, and the study of critical thinking and the study of avoiding falsehoods and logical traps and logical fallacies.
I think, Steve, my final question for today would be something I've been trying to ask you for like a couple of days now, but in terms of like scientific literacy, why do you think, as a Stoic or even a non-Stoic, it is so important to be grounded in good science?
Well, the Stoics would say that we're trying to live according to nature. That's sort of the motto. And you don't know how to kind of fit into nature if you don't have any idea how nature works. And in the same sense, that's sort of the view of why you would study physics. And at the same time, studying something like the scientific method, which is a form of critical thinking, applied critical thinking, will help you to understand what kind of questions to ask, when not to just accept things because someone said it, because of authority. You know, never accept that something's true just because someone important said it, but to ask to see the evidence. And that is something that could help us out immensely in all fields of life if we were a little more critical and a little more willing to dig a little bit before we accept something as likely true. And if we could just get that across and into our public education a little more deeply, I think we'd be a lot better off.
I think there's an excellent place to stop, actually, of this, you know, in this podcast, that our message in the end is to, you know, to be more scientifically grounded, to be more scientifically literate, to value truth, to value the discovery of fact, or at least the facts that we can obtain.
Right.
To enjoy the wonder and to not lose wonder just because we make poor decisions about clearance of habitat or eating the young of passenger pigeons. I think that's great. That's an excellent thing to end on.
But before I hit stop, I need to know, were Neanderthals rational? Are they in the human sphere?
I would say, yeah, good question. I've had a big fight, but I think the evidence points in terms of a Stoic framework, the evidence points to, yes, they were sufficiently rational for them to come under the ring of humanity and not to be included in the ring of Earth. Now, they may not be as rational as us. They may not have had the cumulative culture that we had. It's difficult to say because they died out. But we can certainly say that they were sufficiently human enough to warrant, I would say, special concern in our circles of concern as Stoics. And that needs to be thought about in terms of our wider implication of why is that important today and what that means for our day-to-day activities and choices.
Well, excellent. Well, thank you very much, Kai, for joining the podcast today. Anything new, anything coming up in the future we should know about? Should we keep our eyes on the internet for more publications in the future?
Yeah, we're currently working on a paper about Stoicism and sustainable education. So it's very linked to this. You have to invite me back on. We have to have a discussion more about where education, particularly scientific education, linking into justice and sustainable development fits in. Because I feel that the last time this was really developed properly in terms of Stoic education was in 1973. So hopefully when you read the paper, you'll get a lot of interesting information of papers that have been obscured a little bit that aren't very easy to get hold of. So it's not true that modern Stoicism has only been around in sort of the 90s. It was actually back in the 60s and 70s there was information, but a very, very small community. So we do go into a little bit of detail on that. So hopefully the reviewers won't remove that stuff.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
So you'll be able to get information. But if anybody wants to know about the modern Stoic movement that happened slightly before we often identify modern Stoicism as having happened, you can talk to me. And I think he was based at the University, Sherman, his name is Robert Sherman, he's based at the University of Alabama.
Really?
So yeah, please talk to me. You can go to the papers. My email addresses are on there. You can tweet me and you'll probably find me in the Facebook group. So thanks, Steve, for having me on. And I look forward to talking to you another day about Stoicism and sustainable education.
Thank you for listening to the Sunday Stoic podcast. You can contact the show at sundaystoic@gmail.com. You can leave a voicemail for the show at 501-503-3132. And keep in touch by following us on Facebook and Twitter. You can support the show by donating on Patreon, www.patreon.com/sundaystoic. You can also help us out by rating us on iTunes or whichever podcast provider you use. Thank you for your support. Carpe diem.